Hey, well, welcome to Central Baptist Church. It's great to have you here with us tonight, and it's Wednesday night. Typically, these are our prayer times, our prayer night, and prayerfully, I do ask you to continue to pray for us. We are opening back up, ready for everything, this Sunday. So follow us on Facebook. Stay tuned in to our website, centralbaptistcolumbus.org, and we'll have further announcements coming in regards to this weekend, Memorial Day weekend. And, you know, I say reopen, we never actually never closed, okay? Our doors have always been open, but we have always been very careful in regards to social distancing. We do have masks available. I believe there's biblical truths to honor the king, obey our magistrates, and follow our political leaders, okay? As long as they're not asking us to do anything contrary to Scripture. And so, hey, though, I am ready to get back into church. I'm ready to be excited about that. And we've been answering questions ever since we've been streaming live. Questions have come into the church through emails and so forth. And I thought they were good questions. And last week, we addressed the question of being born again. What does it mean to be born again? Well, when we're born, our first birth was a physical birth. And as we know, there's no good thing in my flesh. And Jesus said, that which is flesh, and that which is spirit. And there's no good thing in our flesh. So our first birth is our physical birth. But to be a child of God's, you have to experience a second birth. And that's being born again, born of the Spirit, that is the Holy Spirit of God. And the Holy Spirit is essential for the Christian life. The Holy Spirit is essential, it's effectual, and it's eternal, right? Born of the Spirit, ye must be born again. That was last week, last Wednesday night, in our messages. And I encourage you, I'm grateful for all of you who've been tuning in. And we've been doing a series now on Sunday mornings about the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5. And then on Sunday nights, faith under fire. We've been talking about our faith being challenged even in times like today, times like this right now. And then now on our Wednesday nights, we've been just kind of answering doctrinal truths or questions in regards to doctrinal truths, like what does it mean to be born again? And tonight we will address the question is, what does it mean to be saved? But I guess as we start tonight, the greatest thing we must always remember is God's love. Because of Jesus Christ, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we have a new life in Christ. And it's because of His love for us. And the Scriptures tell us in Romans 5:8, but God commendeth His love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Like I said last week, I've said it this way, while I was doing Him wrong, He was doing us right. Let's sing together, And Can It Be?
And can it be that I should trust in the Savior's blood? Died He for me, who caused His pain for me, who Him to death pursued? Amazing love, how can it be that Sarah tries to
My chains fell off. You know, it kind of reminds you of when Jesus called Lazarus, right? Lazarus, come forth, and out of the grave he arose. Hey, it's welcome again. It's great to have you here tonight, and I do want to thank our church and all of you listeners. You have been faithfully giving, online giving, and even mailing in and dropping off, and our missionaries are grateful for all that. We've been able to continue supporting our missionaries and help in many, many other areas. I am grateful for this church, and I never, ever, I never take for granted the calling of God. As Paul said, I thank my God who called me and put me into the ministry. Unworthy to be a servant, but forever and eternally grateful to have that opportunity to do so. So hey, to learn more about Central Baptist Church, visit our website, centralbaptistcolumbus.org. On that, you can see our doctrinal statement, learn more about the gospel, and there's opportunities there to give and support the work here at Central Baptist Church and Central Columbus and reaching out to our community. With that being said, I'm going to continue on with our service tonight. And, you know, last week we talked about being born again, and Jesus Christ, right? He calls us out of the grave. The Holy Spirit draws us. Jesus Christ calls us. And we are dead to ourselves, but we're called up out of that grave to live a new life in Christ. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become. And it is a glorious day, a new life in Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 21 and 22 read this. For since by man came death, that was by Adam, by man came also the resurrection of the dead, that's Jesus Christ. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Let's stand, we'll sing together. Glorious day. What a glorious day it is when Jesus Christ calls you out of the grave.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I
God called me out of that grave, and is a new life in Christ. Old things passed away, a new life today. Ladies and gentlemen, you can have that new life in Christ through salvation in Jesus Christ. Acts chapter number 16 is our reading tonight. Acts chapter number 16. We're going to begin reading in verse number, 28. All right, and we'll read together. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." Now the setting here is Paul and Silas and them. They were in prison. Ground shook. Man, the prison bars were opened, and man, it was crazy, right? And the guard there, he was going to, he saw that he'd fallen asleep and he saw that the gates were open and everything was there and he was going to fall on his sword to take his own life. And Paul said, no, don't do that. Paul, that's when he said, don't, we're all here. In verse 29, then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house. Let's pray. Father, we ask your blessing upon the reading, the teaching, the preaching, and the application of your word. And Lord, I pray, please, Father, may your Holy Spirit move in a powerful way tonight to all who are here, all who are listening. Speak to us, minister to us, Father. May we set everything aside and allow the Holy Spirit to have his way with us. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. So as you know, we've been answering questions. Some questions have been coming in online, and the question last week was, hey, what does it mean to be born again? And so I answered, we talked about that last week, what it meant to be born again. And as I mentioned before, our preaching, our series is right now. I've just been kind of teaching on several things. Sunday mornings have been the fruit of the Spirit. Sunday nights have been faith under fire. And then on Wednesday nights, now we've been answering questions, and I've been really enjoying that. And tonight, we are going to address the question, what does it mean to be saved? What does it mean to be saved? And ladies and gentlemen, that was a question that I had in my own life before being a believer. Now listen, I was going to church, and I grew up in church, and we talked about that last week. And that word saved, you know, people used to come to me and say, you know what, you need to get saved. I'm like, you know what, you really need to just, I know what I believe, and you need to get on my face, okay? All right? But you know what the bottom line is I needed to be saved. But I didn't understand what that meant, right? And so I started doing a word search in the Bible a little bit and realized that that word saved is all the way throughout the Scriptures, right? And I came to the realization in Luke chapter 2 that if I didn't need to be saved, then why did God give us a Savior? Born unto you on this day in the city of David is a Savior. His name is Christ the Lord. Ladies and gentlemen, maybe you're watching tonight, maybe you're here tonight, and you'd say, Pastor, what does it mean to be saved? It means to put your trust in the Lord Savior Jesus Christ, to believe in Him, and we're going to go talk about that tonight, to believe in Him and to repent and to receive Him. But so tonight's question, tonight's title, the title of tonight's service is this. Three simple questions. Number one, what must I do to be saved? It was asked in Acts chapter 16, verse number 30. And brought them out, the jailer did. He brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Number one, what must I do to be saved? Well, first off, in answering that question, you need to realize that you need to be saved. You can't be saved until you realize you need to be saved. Ladies and gentlemen, sin separates us from a holy God. We talked about this last week. Sin separates us from God. It says in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 2, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you. Ladies and gentlemen, our sin separates us from God. In Isaiah, he said, "Let us reason together. Though your sins be scarlet, God wants to make us white as snow." In Hebrews 9:27, as quoted last week, for God shall bring every work into judgment, and with every secret thing, whether it be good or evil. I'm sorry, that's in Ecclesiastes chapter 12. In Hebrews 9:27, it says, it is appointed unto man once to die, then the judgment. And I'll read that verse again. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or evil. My dear friends, there's coming a day that we will come face to face with Jesus Christ. And we will give an answer. We'll come face to face with God. And we'll give an answer for the life that we lived. Now here's the option. You see, you must be saved from your sins because we can't answer for them ourselves. But when you put your trust in Jesus Christ, he tells the Father that their sins have been pardoned. In that day, Romans 2:16 reads, in that day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, we, you, me, we need a Savior. Sin separates us from God. We will be judged for our sins. But then as you look at man-made religion or other religions, remember we talked about it last week, Christianity is not based on religion. It's based on a relationship. But the problem with some religions reveal man's attempt to get back to God. Morality. Well, I live a moral life. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's great that you live a moral life, but there is no physical way that our good deeds can outweigh our bad deeds, right? The things we do wrong. We say, well, Pastor, I don't live that bad of a life. You know, I don't. No, hold on a minute before you answer that question. Have you ever lusted after anything? Well, that's a sin. I'm not just talking about physical lust. Have you ever wanted your neighbor's house? You know, have you ever wanted your neighbor's car? That's lusting. Lusting is desiring something that's not yours. That's a sin. Have you ever had an evil thought? Have you ever had hatred towards somebody? I mean, we're not just talking about the Ten Commandments. You can't follow those anyway. But God, Jesus, brings it to a higher level in the New Testament. Our sins separate us from God. So yeah, living a moral life is a good thing, but it's not good enough. Doing good works is not good enough. Religion will not get you to heaven. It's a relationship. Church membership. Well, I'm a member of this church and I give and I serve and I do this and I do that. And remember the one man said, I've cast out demons, he told Jesus. We've cast out demons in your name. And he said, depart from me, for I knew you not. You see, sometimes we rely upon ourselves when really it's all based on a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. What must I do to be saved? You need to believe in the Lord Jesus, right? So we'll kind of keep going in this, all right? There's man's attempt to get back to God, but it's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. Christ provided the way to God. As mentioned many times before, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, the scripture says, for Christ also hath once suffered for our sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. Colossians 1:14, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, as mentioned previously before the service, but God commendeth his love towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ Jesus died for us. What must I do to be saved? Ladies and gentlemen, one, you need to realize that you need to be saved. You need to realize you need to be saved. Three simple questions. One, what must I do to be saved? Question number two, what does it mean to be saved? I think that's a great question. What does it mean to be saved? Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are saved from our sins. But let me go back to number one, the first question. I apologize for this. What must I do to be saved? Number one, under that, you must believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's go back to our text. Then he called for a light, the jailer, and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. You must believe that Jesus Christ, it's the gospel, that God became man, and he dwelt among us. And he lived a perfect life, a sinless life. He was crucified, dead, and buried. And he rose again, according to the scriptures. And that's where we put our faith. He died so that we could live. He gave his life. Ladies and gentlemen, salvation is not found in any other name but in the name of Jesus Christ. You must first believe that God became flesh and he dwelt among us and we beheld his glory. He lived a perfect life. He was the perfect Lamb of God, which took away the sins of the world. Our sins need to be paid for. And Jesus Christ paid for our sins. What must I do to be saved? You must believe. You must also repent. In Mark chapter number 1, verse 15, I'd like to read this verse to us. We must repent, otherwise turn from our sins. In saying, Jesus said, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. It's a relationship. I'm not quite sure how to explain it. I always question myself on this. And explaining it in a way for all to see and for all to understand. Believing the love of Christ. That Christ gave his life. Jesus' desire was for us to follow him, for us to trust him. And when you realize the love of Christ that he has for us, we'll repent. The word repent means to turn, means to turn from our sinful ways and follow after godliness, righteousness, goodness, for his glory. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Repent. Turn from your sins. What must I do to be saved? Believe, repent, and receive. Receive the spirit of adoption, right? Receive the Holy Spirit. So what does it mean? What does it mean to be saved? What must I do to be saved? Believe in the Lord Jesus. Repent of your sins and receive Christ as your personal Savior. So you know what? I want you to be the Lord of my life. May you live, and not I, but may I live for you. What does it mean to be saved? 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us, you know what? Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. What does it mean to be saved? We're saved from our sins. You've heard me say it many times here in our invitations or at the end of a service. Only Jesus saves. Jesus Christ saves me from our sins. He saved me from my sins. Sin brings forth death. But we have life, life eternal, through Jesus Christ. We are saved from our sins, number one. All right, two, we're saved from an eternal hell. Otherwise, you can say it this way, Jesus Christ saves us a place in his heaven. You see, God, a loving God, you'd say, how can a loving God send anyone to hell? He doesn't. By us choosing not to follow Christ, we choose to go the other way. He saves us from our sins. He saves us from an eternal hell. And he saved me. And he can save you from a current lifestyle. Ladies and gentlemen, the world today, yes, some would say that we have a drug issue, but in all honesty, it's a spiritual issue. There are many addictions out there. But we can be set free from the bondage of sin, from addiction, and whatever it may be. Ladies and gentlemen, only Jesus saves. What does it mean to be saved? You have, what it clearly means is you have a new life in Christ. What must I do to be saved? Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Repent of your sins and turn, and receive Christ as your Savior. What must I do to be saved? What does it mean to be saved? What means to be saved is you have a new life. Old things are passed away. I have a new life. So, ladies and gentlemen, when you trust Christ as your Savior, and you begin to live a life for Jesus Christ, that means I'm no longer going to do the things that do not glorify God, but I'm going to live a life that brings glory to God. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Therefore, it reads in Romans, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. We are to put off the old man and put on the new man. What does it mean to be saved? You have a new life in Christ. And number three in your outline, ladies and gentlemen, what is required of me now that I am saved? These are three simple but yet very complex questions. Number one, what must I be saved? Number two, what does it mean to be saved? Number three, what is required of me now that I am saved? We should live for Christ and for Christ alone. And we should serve Him. He owns us. We have been purchased. Christ paid a price. And so it says in Corinthians, what? Know you not that you're not your own? You've been bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. Salvation. You could say it this way. Rescued, redeemed, purchased, saved. The prophet Joel said it this way. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be redeemed. Paul quotes that again in the book of Acts when it says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And he says it again in the book of Romans chapter 10. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. What does it mean to be saved? That was always a huge question of mine. And I understand that question by many. And just to kind of summarize what we've already talked about, what does it mean to be saved? First, I have to come to the realization that I need to be saved from my sins, and I can't do that. Because if we could have done that ourselves, Jesus Christ would not have had to go to the cross. So with that being said, we cannot. It is virtually impossible to save yourself. And only Christ and Christ alone can save us from our sins. He went to the cross. The only sufficient sacrificial payment for our sins. And remember, our sins separate us from God, a loving God. And Jesus Christ willingly went to the cross for us. In John 3:16, a passage that is very popular, very familiar to many of you, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. But God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. A lot of times we think or we have the conception in our mind that Jesus just came to judge and Jesus came to condemn, and he didn't do that. Now, I know many Christians who are condemning and many Christians who are critical of others. And that's really not what we've been saved to. We've been saved to bring glory to God. In verse number 18 of John chapter 3, it says, "He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." Ladies and gentlemen, God does not condemn you. We condemn ourselves. And it's only, salvation is only through Jesus Christ. What must I do to be saved? You must believe. It is our unbelief. In verse 36 of John chapter 3, "He that believeth in the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him." We cannot pay for our own sins. If you do not put your trust in Jesus Christ, we will be punished in eternal hell because of our sins. And you'd say, "Well, how could a loving God send anyone to hell?" He doesn't. We do that on our own by not believing. God gave us his Son, Jesus Christ, and we have access to him. It's a relationship. What must I do to be saved? Believe, repent, turn from your ways, receive him as your Savior. What does it mean to be saved? And I know this is all review. What does it mean to be saved? It means that Christ has saved us from our sins, and only he can. He saves us a place in his heaven. And he saves us from ourselves. He saves us from our selfishness. He saves us from our current lifestyle. He saved me from me. My selfishness, my sinfulness, unrighteousness. Does it mean that I don't sin? No, I still sin. And he forgives me. Because when you confess your sins, he, Jesus Christ, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Only Jesus saves. What does it mean to be saved? It means I'm redeemed. It means I'm rescued. It means I have a new life in Christ. And what is required of me now that I'm saved? Well, I should live a new life for his glory. I should live for him. Live for the one who gave his life for me. We should also serve him. In Psalm 100, possibly one of my favorite psalms, and I'll close with this. "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing." Ladies and gentlemen, as a child of God's, as a follower of God, as a believer in God, we should rejoice. We should praise him. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with thanksgiving and singing. Ladies and gentlemen, as a Christian, we should be in church. We should be in the Word of God. We should be praying daily, reading the Word daily. Ladies and gentlemen, this burdens my heart. It burdens my heart. As Christians, as saved individuals, there is no reason why we should not be reading God's Word, living God's Word, because we're believing God's Word. You know, we pray, right? Our praying is us talking to God, right? But reading His Word is us listening to what God has to say. Oh, I've met many people that claim to be Christians, my brothers and sisters. And they go to church, and they serve, and they do this, and they do that, and they do all these things. But how often do they listen to the Word of God? Please. What does it mean to be saved? It means to be born again. A child of God's. You're one of His. And He is the Lord of your life. It's ownership. It's ownership. What is required of me now that I'm saved? We should live for Him. We should serve Him. We should worship Him. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before His presence with singing. Know ye, verse number 3, Psalm 100, know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are His people in the sheep of His pasture. Ladies and gentlemen, we have nothing, and we are nothing without Him. In fact, we're just basically dust. But He brings life, right? What's required of me now that I'm saved? We should live unto Him, and we should serve Him. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. You know what? Enter into His courts. That's entering into the Holy of Holies. That's entering into His presence to call out, right? And be thankful. The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews that we can come boldly before the throne of grace and ask for help and mercy in a time of need. That's all because of what Jesus Christ did for us. He tore the veil from the top down so that we could have access. What does it mean to be saved? It's a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, right? He gave His life so that we could live. For the Lord is good, verse number 5, Psalm 100. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endureth to all generations. May I review now rather quickly. What must I do? The question was asked is, what does it mean to be saved? It means to be rescued. It means to be redeemed. It means to have victory. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. It means to have a new life. I'm saved from my old life to live a new life for Jesus Christ. It's the same as being born again, rescued from the depths of hell to live a glorious life in Jesus Christ. What must I do? As the jailer said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll go back to the passage. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and your household. Ladies and gentlemen, fathers and mothers out there, when you begin to live a life for the glory of God, your whole house will change. Your children will see a difference in you. Your friends will see a difference in you. Your colleagues at work will see a difference in you. Let the Spirit of God live and dwell in you and have an impact on all the people around you. What must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and your house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were there in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all his straightway. Ladies and gentlemen, baptism doesn't save you. But I say it this way quite often in church. You don't need to be baptized to be saved, but you need to be saved to be baptized. Baptism is an outward expression of an inward confession. When we baptize people here at Central, we say it this way: buried in the likeness of Christ's sacrificial death, raised in the likeness of His glorious resurrection to walk in newness of life. What does it mean to be saved? It means we're going to put to death the old man and we're going to live a new life in Christ, born again, saved. What must I do to be saved? Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Repent ye and believe the gospel and receive the spirit of adoption. What does it mean to be saved? It means we have a new life. And what is required of me now that I am saved? We give him glory. We give him praise. And we live for him and him alone. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them. The jailer fed Paul and fed Silas, and they fellowshiped together, and they lived together. I mean, not lived together, but they rejoiced together, and they spent that time together. It's fellowshipping, right? And that's what I'm looking forward to. I'm so looking forward to getting back to church, having our pews filled, having our nursery filled, children's church, everything getting back to normal. And ladies and gentlemen, I believe that is coming, and I rejoice in just thinking that we're going to have that again. As we come to a conclusion, the question that was asked, what does it mean to be saved? It means a new life. Saved from my old life of death, destruction, and for me, it was drugs and many other things. Old things are passed away. They're gone. What does it mean to be saved? Saved from my old life and saved for a new life. It's kind of like being rescued if you were drowning. Jesus would come out and rescue you and bring you to shore, clean you all up, and use you for his kingdom. Maybe you're watching tonight, and you've never trusted Christ as your Savior. You know, at the end of this, there's a clip that we show. And I'm just kind of talking about salvation and making a decision. But I want to share with you tonight. Maybe you're watching tonight, and you've never trusted Christ as your Savior. Please, I beg of you. There's only one way into heaven. There's only one way to bring glory to God. There's only one way to live for Christ. And that's to be born again. As to be saved. Jesus and only Jesus saves you from your sins. He can, and only Christ can save you a place in his heaven. And he and he alone can only save you from self-destruction. He can only save you from your current situations. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but acknowledge him in all your ways and let him direct your paths. Peter said it this way as he was sinking in the sea. Three very powerful words. Lord, save me. Tonight, maybe you're watching tonight and you've never trusted Christ as your Savior. Would you cry out with me tonight those three words? Lord, save me. I believe that Jesus died for me on the cross. I turn from my sinful ways. I repent. And I receive Christ as my Lord and Savior tonight. Lord, save me. And I love the words there in Matthew when Jesus said, Jesus stretched forth his hand and he pulled Peter up out of the water. He said, ye of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? May we never doubt the word of God, but may we read the word of God. May we believe the word of God, and may we live the word of God. Lord, save me. Maybe you're watching tonight and you are a Christian. You have trusted Christ as your Savior, but you've gone astray. You're not quite following him in the way that you should. It's the same three words. Lord, save me. Save me from my selfishness. Save me from my sin. Save me from my current situation. Lord, save me. And when after trusting Christ as your Savior, and after allowing him to rescue you, save you, and redeem you, now we have to live for him. Otherwise, let Christ reign. Let the Spirit of God live and dwell and reign. Otherwise, have rule over you. In fact, in Galatians 5:25, the scriptures read this. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Tonight, would you make a commitment with me to let him reign? Let's sing together.
and your heart is fit to burst when you hear that quiet whisper and the fire begins to burn. When you know deep down inside you there is something you must do, let the Holy Spirit make his home in you. Let him reign, let him reign now, let the Holy Spirit make his home in you. When you're walking through the darkness and the mountain seems too high, when the ocean waves around you and the flame begins to die, when you face those times of trouble but you know his love is true, let the Holy Spirit make his home in you. Let him reign. Stars unveil the night. It's beyond imagination how the world reveals his mind. I am precious, I am treasured, he delights in what he sees. Holy Spirit, will you make your home in me? Let him reign.
Thank you for tuning in today. And at the end of every service here at Central, we have typically what we call an invitation. An invitation is the opportunity to make a decision. Today, if you've never made the decision to trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, may I encourage you to do so. Jesus Christ, and only Jesus, saves us from our sins. He saves us a place in his heaven, and he saves us from a current situation. Ladies and gentlemen, salvation is only found in Jesus. In fact, Jesus himself said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And we have that promise because God loves us. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. And whosoever believeth in him shall never perish, but have everlasting life. I don't know what you may be facing today. You may be carrying the weight of the world on your shoulders. And Jesus said, come unto me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. There may be concerns and cares that are burdening you. Peter said, cast your cares upon him, upon Jesus Christ, because he cares for you. Jesus, the Word of God, clearly tells us, clearly, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Jesus, his desire is for all to be saved. Today, maybe you've never trusted Christ as your Savior. I encourage you to do so. Maybe you are burdened. Maybe you're discouraged, depressed, and in despair. Do not be destroyed. Do not allow the enemy to distract you. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but acknowledge him in all your ways and let him direct your paths. Trust the Lord, follow the Lord, and glorify the Lord, all by believing in the Lord and love the Lord. Today, would you make a decision with me today to trust the Lord? Believe in him, receive him, and glorify him. Thank you so much for tuning in. We'll see you next time.